In this video, I'm going to break down my workflow and process for creating this animation in After Effects. In this episode of Animating Great Artists, I'm tackling this design from Johan Eriksson, crazy talented designer and animator working at Buck in New York. We'd previously collaborated where he'd animated my design of this floppy disk. Johan sent me this design beautifully layered and labeled in Illustrator, because we always label our layers. I was particularly impressed with these gradients looking so natural, and these were all using the gradient fill set to radial and the aspect ratio stretched. I imported this straight into After Effects by pressing Ctrl plus I, selecting the file and importing it as a composition, retaining the layer sizes, which gives me a comp looking like this. My first step is to tidy this up. I spent about 10 minutes color coding everything and parenting all the objects, so the blue skin elements were all colored blue and the eyes and ears are all parented to the head. It's really important to start as organized as possible. It'll make everything to come much easier. From here, I went straight into blocking, which is the most important phase. Blocking is where we animate the minimal amount to get the story across and establish the timing. It's very tempting to animate straight ahead from start to finish, making sure the head turn feels nice and smooth here, but that can lead to a lot more work later on if the overall timing isn't established and we need to make changes. I'm only animating three things here: the position of the head, the pupils, and this top purple ball. I've animated all of these with hold keyframes. To turn your regular keyframes into hold keyframes, select them all, right click, and select toggle hold keyframes. This removes any motion between them and they will jump straight to that position, no in-betweens. And these additional neck objects are just appearing on. It might look really basic, but this sets up the whole animation and where most of the decision making happens. From here on in, all the additional animation is reacting to this. So take your time to get this right. This is a great time to get input from your art director or even get timing approvals from your client. The next step is turning those hold keyframes into regular keyframes. So instead of that head snapping from side to side, there's a motion between that. I'm still not adding any easing because I know that'll get messy once that happens and I want to figure out where all the motion will be first. I've added a little anticipation and follow through to the springing up and down of the head. So before he springs up, he goes a little bit lower, building up energy for that explosive thrust upwards. And then he extends a little further and settles down to his final position. I'm also animating the head using a null controller, which is just a null that the head's parented to. This is so that I could do some independent animation with the head, maybe with the scale that wouldn't affect everything parented to it. And it gives me a few more options that I might need later. The next phase was adding easing, and I'm only adding that to the head at the moment because these other neck bits would react to that head motion once I'd finalized it. For most of the easing, I pressed F9 on my keyboard to add an easy ease. I went into the graph editor and then pushed those handles to make it a bit more severe and more of a snappy motion. For the head position, I separated the X and Y dimensions because I really like to work in the value graph when fine-tuning anticipation and follow-through, and separating the dimensions makes that much easier. For the bounce, I really wanted to have a lot of control where it slowly eased downwards in position and then shot up really quickly. And it's great to be able to just concentrate on the Y position for that. I also added an adjustment layer to the very top of everything, with the post-rise time effect set to 12.5 frames per second, because I thought a lower frame rate would suit this design. The next stage was animating the neck shapes. For the bottom two pieces, they just scale up and rotate slightly, rotating the opposite way to the piece above them as the head looks around. For the top pieces, as they appear, they're launched up a bit further by the main head movement, and then settle back down with a bit of a bounce. The bounce is made by keyframing the up and down positions of the balls, and then only adding an easy ease to the topmost positions. You can see here they alternate between a linear keyframe and one with easing as it's hanging in the air, waiting to fall down. This keeps the bounce feeling like it's a rigid object. Next, I added the secondary motion. The body turns slightly by animating the shape path. The head turn was animated by unlinking the scale property and shifting the x-axis. So when he's facing forward, it's 100% on both. And when he's a bit more to the side, it's only 89% scaled on the x-axis. So he's less wide when he's turning away. To get the correct ear in front and behind the head, what I did was I duplicated each ear, so I had a left and a right ear in front and behind the head. And with the front ears, I animated the opacity property of each from 0 to 100 with hold keyframes. So when one is 0% opaque, the other one is 100%, turning one off and one on when the head turns. And I added a small secondary bounce to the head as the purple ball hits it on its way down. The last step was adding the details. For the shadows, I created a black shape layer, added the set matte effect, taking in the matte from the layer below it, and then parenting it to the shape above, so it only appears when the objects get close. These stars were animated by just increasing the scale position and then decreasing it again. And for these exploding little line bursts, for the three in the bottom left, I extended the drawing so they were longer and they almost touched the edge, and then I've animated them just using a mask on each one. So each one has a mask, and that moves from the center outwards, revealing part of the line underneath, and that gives the illusion that they're bursting outwards. For this squiggly one up here, I used trim paths and put this on a separate layer so that these little loops would work nicely and look like it was drawn on, which I couldn't do with the mask. And this was the final product. I find it really useful to only concentrate on one element at a time, working from the most important movement down to the little details. We end up with a lot of keyframes and reactive animation at the end here, and that can be really overwhelming to get started with if you don't have a clear process.
I've made a short playlist of some related videos that I'll think you'll enjoy if you've made it this far. I'll see you in the next video, and please consider subscribing if you'd like more of these videos every week.